What candy now?
The gentleman, legend in my opinion, who have portrayed the character of the prince for the past 3 or so decades. So, they're all here tonight. So, everybody in this building right now, this is our main event. We are going to legitimately make history.
No running, folks. Please just take it easy.
We're bringing more people in, by the way, but I'm still starting the panel. So, anyways, we are making history. This is the prince of all panels, as we have 3 Vegetas who are going to share their wisdom and knowledge of portraying the prince for all of us. So, without any further ado, it is time to bring them out. Are you ready?
My arm is going to go numb, I can already tell.
First, representing the Great White North, he has voiced Vegeta since 1996. And he's been on so many cartoons, I can't even list them all for you. The creator of over 9,000, the OG of this character when it came to the English-speaking fandom. Please welcome, with love and admiration, Mr. Ryan Drummond.
I just saw Kate right there.
He's filming me, I'm filming you.
Vegeta and has portrayed the character since 1999. Star of several Dragon Ball Z movies, every Dragon Ball Z, GT, and Super episode, who needs no introduction, an ambassador. He is the personification of Dragon Ball in the Western Hemisphere. Please welcome Christopher Sabat.
Start with a kind of a simple question for all you guys.
What is the one thing about Vegeta's character from beginning to end that you have taken sort of, and you're basically, what is the thing you admire most about the character of Vegeta?
Oh, can I ask the audience to do can I use my lifeline? Phone a friend? I think the thing I love about Vegeta the most, the thing that I'm really proud of to be able to play this character for, is he has had the most change over the series of any other character. Someone was coming up with like, hey, do you like Piccolo or Vegeta more? And I go, well, okay, let's talk about Vegeta's backstory. He had a really crummy childhood. He was like raised by a king. It was a like horrible planet where they destroyed things and like, and then it was taken over by someone else, the planet was destroyed, and then he kind of meets somebody, his son comes from the future, blah, 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 blah. And then he has a wife, and blah, blah, blah. And all these things happen to him, and then Piccolo, he comes from an egg. That's it. So it's just, what I love about Vegeta is he's constantly adapting, and he's becoming such a better person that it's hard to believe that in the beginning of the series, I have to remind myself and some people, like, wow, you guys are all... Like your kids want like wear Vegeta shirts and stuff. That dude killed people. Like he killed Nappa just for sucking or something. I think so. It's just his ability to kind of adapt and change, just to become a better person, is what I love about him.
As a performer, and I don't know if I can speak for everybody, for myself, what I love is a character that has nuance. So a villain or a hero, someone who's always the same, always just a badass, the bad guy, is not nearly as interesting as a performer as a character that has nuance, that has change. And that was the first word that came to me, and you basically explained it, is there's change and a journey that you want them to start somewhere and go somewhere. That's always so much more exciting to me. And then you get sucked in and drawn into what's happening to them. When they're struggling, when they're in pain, when they're filled with anger, when they're filled with pride, when they want to fight, when they want to run, it's with Vegeta, it's all there. And that's what's so fun to play a character like that.
Translation.
I feel the same as Brian and Chris, that the growth that he had was wonderful. I guess the most wonderful thing about his character. And he grew as a person, and he also grew in his strength as well. He started out as such an evil guy, and then he evolved into someone who wasn't just fighting for himself anymore, but fighting for others, fighting for his family, fighting to protect things. So that was a really wonderful thing to portray.
We know that Mr. Sabat wants Mr. Drummond. My question is, Mr. Drummond, did you ever get a chance to watch back then Mr. Sabat's performance as Vegeta after you had done it first? And then my other question is, Mr. Horikawa, when did you first check out any of the English dubs?
Wow, that's an excellent question.
You better answer this well.
Yeah. Well, anytime a role moves away from you to someone else, a performer is bound to be curious as to how it all comes together. And knowing that Chris initially had to copy to his best ability what I was doing, I don't know if I thought he did a very good job. When it's your own voice and you hear someone else doing it, you don't know if it sounds the same as what you're doing. I will say, I love what Chris does right now with Vegeta. And had I thought of a voice anywhere near as with what you do, I would have done it in a heartbeat. But I can't do that voice, so I had to go with something far more princely, I would say. But I you know what? Everyone always wondered, what was it like? Did it tick you off? No. I was a working guy. I was working on other shows, and I was just, after when I first heard some of the work, I was pumped. That it was still good. I think I was more worried that it was going to be, the show was going to be bad and falter and not be any good, but everything I've seen of it, I've loved. The fan base for years I've loved, and it's just been a hoot to be a part of it. Absolutely.
For many years, I had two layers of trying to be humble about this role. Because there was the Japanese layer of, well, I'm not the original Japanese voice. And then there was this layer of, well, I'm not even the original English-speaking voice of the show. And I was terrified because when we took over for the Canadian cast, we were just this tiny little studio in North Texas, kind of trying to throw something together. And we had taken these roles from veterans in this industry. I mean, Vancouver is just known for its stellar voice work. And so I was terrified of even trying to keep up with the legacy that he had already created for the character, and also not to freak out all the 6 and 7 year olds who are watching the show that suddenly had all their voices changed. And it meant a lot to me when Brian came up. Like, I met him as soon as we got here, because it was the first chance I've ever gotten to meet him in person. One of the things he said to me was like, man, you did a pretty good job copying me. How long did it take you before you decided you weren't going to do that anymore? And was it like a conscious change, or did you just change it because you just sort of fell down or something, just sort of dropped and got close to your voice? And I told him that it was my conscious effort to kind of go from copying someone to actually playing a character, because it's way, I just didn't want to end up spending my entire life copying the same voice. I wanted it to be something that I could really work with, and if I have to copy something and act on top of that, it's just an extra layer that you didn't need. So I did. And if you can compare Vegeta, a picture of him from the beginning of the series, to a picture at the end of the series, you can tell he goes through a powerful transformation. He grows like testicles between his eyes. Huge shoes, and I started hearing his voice when we started working on the games, because originally we were recording in a vacuum. We never got to hear the original voices. But then I was like, oh, darn it, this guy's amazing too. And I've always had such reverence for Ryo, and I've heard all of his performances on every game and every show since like 2002, and it's always an honor to be around him.
What quality are you recording it, Kang?
I'm just taking pictures.
Oh. I'm at the 1080p and I only got 20 minutes of room on my phone.
So I've actually seen Drummond in English before, and although their voices are very different, they're very different in a very good way, and they both turn them into their own voices, and it's a really fantastic thing that they were able to do.
Lost treasures or mysteries or whatever that, I don't know.
this, but there actually exists somewhere in Canada, somewhere, an ocean dove of Kai. But nobody knows where it's at. Like, for real, it's like a big mystery. Brian told me he reported for it. We don't know where it's at. My question, and this is for everyone, is when you guys came back to portray Vegeta and Kai, now that you knew the entire character arc of the character from beginning to end, how did that affect your performance in the early episodes? Did you know, because you knew the guys were good eventually and be a father and all that, did that change how you approach the character this time?
I'll tell you the only thing that changed for me, I was on a lot more shows and pretty busy. Early when I started Dragon Ball Z, it was one of the first few voiceover projects I had, so I was just screaming my guts out for it. You guys heard some of the early stuff, that just the power stuff I would never do now, because that was the one and only time I've lost my voice in voiceover, was after an 8-hour session. And they changed the rules, we're only allowed to do 4-hour sessions now, but back then we could do an 8-hour session as Vegeta and had nothing. I went out to dinner that night with friends, and there was nothing left. I just don't do that anymore. So the first thing I asked when I heard this DBZ Kai was coming was, I know the show, what's different about it? And they said, the fights are shorter. Yes! That was all I cared about. The fights are shorter.
Yeah, the greatest thing about working on Kai for us as a studio and for all the actors, I can speak, I think, on behalf of everyone who worked on that show, the best thing we got to do was really to go back and perfect some of the things that weren't right about the original. Like, I tell everybody, like, go back and watch the orange boxes if you want nostalgia, if you want to remember your childhood. Like, if you want to hear cats love food, yeah. Watch that. And there's nothing wrong with it. It's just its own thing. But we finally got to go back and work on Kai, where we really got to really dial in the correct translation and really accurate writing, and got to tell the story for people who may have wanted to hear it more like the original. And we tried to keep the same flavor along the way. But our main goal this time around was really to make it sound as accurate as possible to the original Japanese while keeping kind of our English flavor to it. Also, when do you ever get a chance to go back and do something that you did 10 years ago again? Like, there's nothing wrong with it. Like, nothing can be bad about that. That's the best, coolest thing, other than it being completely vocally stressful, and I think all of us were in a different place career-wise at that point. It's always nice to be able to go back and get a second chance to do something that you know is beloved.
Did he work on Kai?
Well, the question was, when he came back to voice Vegeta and Kai, knowing what the character arc was, where the character was going, how did he approach that performance versus the first time, especially for Mr. Horikawa, he had already done it, so he knew. Did he approach the character differently this go around? But because he knew what was going to happen.
Did they even do it, Jeff?
You did a wonderful job on Kai, and and your job on Super blows me away. Yeah.
Version of how I got the call. So Chris, did you, when that arc came, you say, I want Brian, was like, how did that, what was your side of contacting him and bringing him back? That whole story.
I'll be honest, it wasn't premeditated. Like, I didn't have the idea like months in advance. He can tell you how much time we had from the time I actually called him to do this and the time the session had a match. It wasn't much, it was like about a week. Because in some ways I was kind of dreading the copy Vegeta arc because I was disappointed that Vegeta didn't get to fight Vegeta as much. Like, I really wanted to fight himself a little bit more. The only thing I found interesting, the thing I found at least the most interesting, was Vegeta having a difficult time knowing who he wanted to root for when Kami was fighting Goku. But I was about a week out, I needed to record the show, and I'm like, I just wanted this to fight. But the engineers were like, hey, do you want to add effect to his voice? Do you want to do something kind of interesting with it? And then suddenly one day I'm like, you know what? I gotta get Brian Drummond to do this. This would be amazing. Like, because the thing I've heard so many of you say to me when I come to conventions is, you know, this is the thing of your childhood. This is, and a lot of you, I know how you must have felt when you were really young, when you were 6 or 7, 8 years old, and then the voices just radically change overnight, and you just had to kind of go, all right, I'm going to deal with it. But the thought to actually put a copy Vegeta on a voice that I originally copied, I thought was so meta. And the idea of giving fans just that sound that they remember from their childhood was going to be such a profound thing. I couldn't resist it, and it turned out better than I could have possibly imagined.
It was a fun call to get. Chris and I had DM tweeted a couple times back and forth about some stuff, and then you mentioned a couple months earlier, hey, you know, maybe she gets together for beers, and if something come up and you maybe want to do something, and I was like, I don't know how that would work, and I'm not sure, and as he said, it was short notice when he said, there's this part, he's another Vegeta, sort of a purple slimy one, but and would you be interested? You know, I'm on a lot of other shows, so I'm just trying to figure out how I would fit it in, and I mentioned, yeah, maybe I'll fly down to Dallas, and he's like, we kind of need it like next week. And I was like, oh, geez. Like, and luckily I had a Monday, this was like a Wednesday or something, and I called the studio I knew and said, guys, can I book you for one of your free studio spots?
How we'll start with Brian and Chris. Do you think it would be easier if you had the other person in the scene there for you to kind of method act off of, or is it not really a big deal?
I would take that 100 times to 1 every day to work off another actor. I do a lot of shows that are pre-lay where there's 5, 10 of us in a studio together working on it's just the scripts in front of us. We don't have mouthwaps to match. We don't have times to match. You're creating every aspect of, with the director of what's going to happen in that scene. You put it all together, and then it's so much of acting is reacting. And it's great if another character could say their dialogue and you can react to how they said that. But in dubbing, like I said many times, I may go and do all the genius lines and I haven't, and the other characters haven't done theirs yet. So I don't have anyone else's performance to react to. I can't even say, oh, can I hear what Peter did with Goku? Not he isn't coming yet. Oh, so I gotta do a reaction line to something I haven't even heard yet. So you're just, you have to make everything up. It's kind of like an actor working on green screen, which you can still do. You've got to react to something that doesn't exist, that hasn't happened yet. Most actors would far prefer to be able to work off another performer. So, if I had an opportunity to do Dragon Ball with the full cast in the room on a weekly basis, that would be unreal. It would just be a blast to do. So much fun.
スケジュールの関係で例えば誰かがその日にはいられないとか、まあ、僕でもそうなんですけど、その時 で、その時に感じて一人だから。で、その時他の人がもうすでにレコーディングが終わってる状態のものをイヤホンで聴きながら、それで合わせてやるっていう。まあ、その時は一人きりですけど、通常は、普通はあのみんなで一緒にやるんですね。だから、
It's weird because it seems like I can understand English without speaking. I've seen that a lot before, too. Like the translator is not really telling him everything that's being said to him. I mean, it's saying what he's saying.
We all record together in the studio, which I think makes it easier for us to communicate with each other. Both of our feelings can connect with each other better, and we can read each other's moods and react to each other. Though there are times when, because of scheduling difficulties, that we're not all able to get together, so sometimes an actor may have to come do a one-on-one session if they weren't able to make it to the recording. But I do feel that it is much easier to match with everybody else if we're all recording at the same time.
Now, the actor side of me agrees with both of you. The producer, director side of me says that's a very difficult task. And because, at least in Western audiences, are extremely used to like mouth movements that pretty much match the characters. Like, it's very difficult. So there's so much of the process that's a technical process on top of it being an acting process that I'm just, because there's so much more dubbed content in Japan, there's more understanding that they're not gonna exactly match the mouth movements, but it's just too difficult for me to escape something that not looking right in the mouth. And it's so hard for me not to do it. I prefer to work off someone every day. And as the owner of the studio where we record the show, I usually get myself the luxury of being able to come in last. So I get to hear everybody else's performances, and then I get to make modifications to my line, so I kind of cheat in a way. I get literally the best seat. If you're the first person to record, it's like the worst, because you're just recording just dry, you're in this vacuum. But if you're the last person, you're essentially recording with everybody else.
Well, yeah, certainly if the show's already animated, there's no, like, having everyone in the group, I would find that to be completely a difficult process, but I was more looking at it from the scope of if Dragon Ball Z wasn't even animated yet, and we actually got to just do it all, and then they animated two of our performances after the fact. That's the way I really love to work, because then actually your facial movements, they many times I've filmed in performances, they say, can we come in and we're filming guys, and they film what we're doing with our faces, when we're angry or we're joking or we're doing things, and the animators will use those to create shows. And that's a prelay environment. And if there was a prelay environment of Dragon Ball, it would be amazing. It would be incredible.
There's one thing certainly that I really want to ask you.
Oh, he's making out the English now.
Are you looking at the script while you're recording, or do you have all the lines memorized?
Whoa,
I haven't memorized a line in a really long time. No, script on the screen.
Yeah, you see the script right here, and the screen's right behind it. You're basically just having to follow both things at one time. Now, but yours sometimes comes in, is not finished, but sometimes yours is like an animatic with the mouth shape. Is that what happens sometimes? Or do you normally see the finished, completely finished episode?
基本的に使うというのは絶対まあ合わせるんですけれど、そこはすごく時間的にも正確に取 だからそういう意味では、なんていうのかな、レコーディングしたものを機械的にずらすことが確かにできるとは思うんだけど、何度もやっぱり本編、リテイクして撮り直していくことが多いんですよね。How many times does it take to record?
Oh, me just once, you know. I'm just I'm kidding. It really varies. Like, it's, we try and do our best on the first take, and sometimes it can take three takes. And that's another thing that would worry me about recording Dragon Ball in a group setting, which blows my mind, is I feel that sometimes the screaming that you do in that show, I think it would be easier if I wasn't able to see anybody else. Like, there'd be this, like...I wouldn't mind no one else was watching me during that because it's pretty intense and you look ridiculous when you're doing it. So I can only imagine that it's like, is there anyone that you're ever nervous around to? Like, are there any of the other cast members you can't even look at when you're screaming?
もうあの録音してる時って基本的に隣の人とかもう見えないんですよね。集中してるからあまり気にならない。
Your favorite character you've ever voiced, or if not,
I do you guys prefer honesty or that I lie to you? Vegeta is one of my all time favorite characters in animation, but not one of my all time favorite characters to voice because of how difficult it was and is for those who are still doing it to do. It is extremely taxing and very hard on the vocal cords, and dubbing work is far more difficult than prelay work, the precision that's involved. You have to work by yourself, not with a group, not as fun for me. I love working with people as opposed to alone. So that's where I put not as fun, but as far as character arc and who the character is and the journey he's been through, he's at the top of my list of all-time favorite characters. So for viewing, that's why I know he is for you too. But for work, when a Dragon Ball session would show up on my calendar from my agent, it was usually something. That's what my head would do. And when a pop-up in two sessions of Dragon Ball Z next week. Can you put them on a Friday so I can have Saturday and Sunday to recuperate? That's sort of where I sit with Vegeta.
said it, it's really hard. And so, I guess, and maybe you're probably aware of that. And I know going into a session that it's going to take all of my, all the power I have to even get through it sometimes. But as a character, it's hard for me to compare it to anything because you never, who else other than like some of the most the famous iconic characters in animation gets to play a character for 20 years. Like it's, and anyone who thinks that he just like went away is wrong because there was video games, there was recuts, there was the orange boxes and the yellow boxes and the Kai and the, and so Vegeta's never left. And it's also hard for me to separate how Vegeta has impacted my life in general, like me as a person, like my whole, I don't even know who I would be now, like my whole identity is connected with that character.
I'd be nobody.
You're right though. I don't know what I would be. So
be Piccolo.
It was such a, I don't know, it sucks to have to scream that loud and to know that I'm gonna have flu-like symptoms the next day. But Dragon Ball Z has given me so much that I don't have a choice, because if I don't scream my butt off, Sean's going to scream better than I do, and I don't want that.
Dragon Ball's only.
Coolest characters ever. I played Dr. Claw. I played Wolverine. I played Venom. And Vegeta, honestly, he's still at the top.
I'll get you next time, Gadget.
Something magical like that night or that day in the studio. You could be screaming or not, it's up to you. I mean, I don't have to explain why this scene was great, but just the moment where Vegeta does sacrifice himself and he puts his arm around his son. I'm sorry. You have to have a heart of stone to play Vegeta, but it crushed me, man. It just crushed me. And it was a difficult emotional recording session. Because back in those days, we were working so hard to get the show on TV every week that we didn't even know what was happening. We didn't even have the materials up until the end of the show. So I didn't even know what was going to happen to Vegeta as things went along. So when he became a Super Saiyan, I was like, oh, wow, that's awesome. And I think in a way, it's kind of the way that Ryo got to experience the series, because he didn't know what the future was going to be either. And we've had conversations about this. Like, one of the funniest things he ever said to me was, man, when I first started working on the show, I didn't even know if I was going to make it 20 episodes, because people die in the show. So that was probably my favorite scene. Yeah, easily.
そうだね、僕はやっぱりここではっきり変わったと思います。なんでもベジータって自分のためだけに戦ってきた、自分が強くなるためだけに戦ってきたから、初めて家族を守るために自分を犠牲にして、そこら辺がもう変わりつつあるというか、今までのヒールだっただけの男が初めて人のために
I like how he's wearing an English It's Over 9000 shirt.
そういうところが一番好きなの。で、あと、そういうこと言うならばやっぱり、トランクスに、お前を抱いたことがないから抱かせてくれというところが一番好き
な
の。チーンで
言う
の
も。Yeah, well done. I noticed it right away.
Like Chris, I had the same scene where Vegeta sacrificed himself against Majin Buu. At that time, we saw his heart change from how he'd been before. The first time, he wasn't just fighting for himself, he was fighting for his family to protect people. And so he made that sacrifice, and especially at the moment when he said to Trunks that, I've never held you before, let me hold you now, that was really, really enjoyed that.
You know what they said. Honestly, I was probably, in remembering work in different scenes, I was probably the giddiest school kid in doing this 4 hours of copying Vegeta recently. When I got to be back in the room and working on those scenes, I was just, this is mostly because of what I knew was going to happen. Like, this is going to be, people are going to disallow this. And I just thought Chris had such a great idea to do it. That's when I was probably the most pumped about an episode. Going, this is going to be fun. Oh, my God, like this.
So I've been talking to these guys all night, but I'm not allowed to. We can't be here all night. But before we close out the Prince of All panels, I would like a special request from Mr. Drummond, Mr. Sabat, and Mr. Horikawa. We've seen you guys kill your local awards for decades and still live to tell about it. And we've seen Mr. Horikawa do Final Flash, but I want to do something a little bit different to close out this epic first, maybe last time ever, hopefully not, but it is the first time ever that you're all in the same room. Can we do a triple Big Bang Attack?
Yes!
I mean, aren't we supposed to hear the Japanese reference first? I mean,
might clip this and I'll put just this.
Can we do that to close out?
Yeah, do it!
How about, can I count you down? I'll give you three dots.
I'm gonna be following you, okay?
I'm gonna say 3, 2, 1, go, and then you go.
All right?
Ready?
All right.
Okay.
Here we go.
All right. 3, 2, 1, go.
Big bang!
Enjoyed it, motherfuckers. Prince of all panels.